Long-time users of opioids face the risk of developing opioid use disorder, a pattern of misuse that can lead to serious impairment or distress. But many can also experience chronic inflammation and, ironically, a heightened sensitivity to pain. Although changes in nerve sensitivity are likely involved, it remains unclear how these effects take hold. Now, scientists from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, along with collaborators at Scripps Research and the Scripps Clinic, report that they might also be influenced by the body's own immune system. Investigators at Scripps Research and elsewhere have been looking into the possibility of creating immune-based vaccines to counteract opioid use disorder. Inspired by this previous work, Cody Winther led the team to pursue an independent experimental effort. This project tests the hypothesis that some negative effects of opioids are caused by antibodies that the body produces against the drugs. Detecting these antibodies in patients' blood would suggest an adaptive immune response is occurring. One potential problem with that theory, however, is size. Opioids prescribed for back pain, such as hydrocodone or oxycodone, are simply too small to elicit an immune response on their own. But the team was encouraged to pursue their line of thinking thanks to a process known as haptenization. This process sees drug molecules collude with proteins in the bloodstream to form larger conjugates that activate an immune response. In a pilot study, the team gathered blood samples from two groups of patients: 19 patients who used either hydrocodone or oxycodone for chronic back pain, and 3 patients who used over-the-counter or non-medication-based approaches. Members of the team then fixed synthetic opioid protein conjugates into test plates. If patients did produce opioid-specific antibodies, they would stick to these large complexes and create a detectable color change. For 10 of the patients who regularly took prescription opioids, that's precisely what the team saw. In fact, the larger the opioid dose, the larger the apparent antibody response observed, even among patients taking large doses for as little as 6 months. Notably, no antibodies have yet been found in the smaller group of samples from patients pursuing over-the-counter treatments. In future studies, key members of the team at UW-Madison will be on the lookout for molecular precursors that prompt the generation of these first-wave IgM anti-opioid antibodies, which are weaker than the IgG antibodies that vaccination normally causes the body to produce. These initial findings warrant a broader study to determine the prevalence of antibodies in people based on not only opioid use history, but also race, age, and sex. If the results appear to hold, they could have consequences for identifying the population of individuals most likely to benefit from anti-opioid vaccine approaches. Individuals with high baseline levels of weak IgM anti-opioid antibodies might be relatively poor candidates for these novel therapeutics, should they become approved for use, while low levels of these antibodies could potentially signal that an individual is a good candidate for developing a strong antibody response following vaccination. Postdoctoral researcher Jillian Kaiser will present the team's findings at the American Chemical Society Fall 2020 virtual meeting and expo.